you, Prasanna ma'am, for that wonderful talk. It was so useful to everyone, and so many comments are coming that it is so useful and excellent. And thank you, ma'am, and thank you, Dr. Shobhana, for that chairing this session. With that, we'll move on to the next session. We have a very senior speaker for that session. Let me share the screen. We have Dr. Sudha, Professor Sudha Prasad, and she is the president of Indian Fertility Society. And she was the former vice president of Fox in the year 2019 and the director of Matritva Advanced IVF and Training Center in New Delhi. And she has the teaching experience for more than 38 years and fellowship in IVF and reconstructive tubal surgery from the Baylor University, US, and started the first low-cost IVF at public sector institution. And she's the former director and professor and IVF coordinator at Maulana Azad Medical College, New Delhi, and former dean, faculty of medical sciences, Delhi University from 2015 to 16, and president AOGD 2016 to 17, and chairperson infertility committee of AOGD from 2009 to 11, and member of infertility committee of FOCSI, and a past member of endometriosis committee. And she has a lot of publications in international and national journals and various infertility textbooks. With these few words, I invite our dearest Professor Sudha ma'am to deliver the talk on fertility in the 40s. And this topic
is very much important. The session is being chaired by Dr. Kunyamadin. Please share the screen, your bio data.
Yeah, that's okay. See, I'm the president of IT Society and
for the joint. For the crowd here, Kunyamadin,
Dr. I think Dr. Kunyamadin, you should share. Please.
Please share and let me have the privilege to read it out.
Yeah, 1 second.
Kunyamadin is an ARMC, owner of ARMC. He's not only done well for himself, he's done well for so many IVF youngsters. He's given a chance for all of them to grow.
Dr. Kunyamadin has 23 years of experience in ART and gynec endoscopic surgeries. He's the chief consultant at ARMC IVF Kozhikode since 2009. Founder, managing director, ARMC IVF Network, Kerala, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu. Chief consultant in reproductive medicine department and founder chairman, ARMC Aegis Hospital, Perindalmanna. Visiting laparoscopic surgeon at Belhol Hospital and KIMS RPC, Dubai. Visiting infertility specialist at Nova Healthcare, Doha, Qatar. Visiting consultant IVF specialist at Modern Al Salama Medical Center, Muscat, Oman. Joint Secretary, Indian Fertility Society, 2020-22. Founder President, Perindalmanna ONG Society, 2020-22, gold medalist in MD Jipma Pondicherry, advanced training in laparoscopy in CF France, training in ART at NUH Singapore, 1998. He is a former consultant at Maulana IVF Perindalmanna, Kerala, 1997-2018. Founder secretary, IFS Kerala chapter, 2016-20.
Thank you, Dr.
Madam Sudha.
Thank you. So,
very happy to
thank you so much. Our learned chairperson, Dr. Kunju Mohideen, is chairing my session. Good evening to all of you. And I just want to convey my regards that you have given me the chance to join this meeting. And I congratulate the President POCS, Dr. Kunju Mohideen, and Dr. Ambuja, the Calicut Indian Menopausal Society, to choose a very perfect topic of 40s and beyond. What all problem occurs at this age, we all see in our practical practical clinics when we are sitting there and we are scratching our head that what all has to be done at this age. The patient has come to me for the fertility after 40 and we have to find out the status of this, what exactly can be done for this patient. We all know that these type of patient, 40 and beyond, are coming to our clinic for the fertility quite a lot. Why they are coming so late? Because we know that the time has come that the patients, the girls, the women, has started thinking about their career, about the economic status, for the financial security, and of course, going for the higher education. So the fertility has become the backbencher now, but suddenly when they think over that, yes, now they want to increase their family, now they want to marry. So finally, this point comes that they reach to their ART center. And of course, our patients in youngster, I think we are in such age, I am in such age that I have lots of patients to think and understand people. But now youngster has no patients. So the incidence rate of divorcing is also too much now. And once they start the second family, by the time it becomes 40 and beyond. Let's see that what happens exactly to the eggs. When it is at the in utero, there can be the 7 million eggs are there inside the ovary. This is most physiological thing which happens, and we keep on reading this. But by puberty, there are many eggs are there which is coming out, one egg coming out every month. But by the age of 40, it becomes absolutely minimal in number. So what happens? The decreased fecundity also is there by the age. So there is a gradual decline in female with the age when they go beyond 35. And of course, it becomes absolutely difficult when they goes beyond 45. So there is a very limited time to have a fertility answer during this phase. When you see the fertility is coming at the in 25 to 29, the fertility is highest. 20 to 24 is the highest, and slowly, gradually, when you see this graph, it is coming down. After 35 to 39, it is coming down, and by 45, it just touching the lower level when it becomes difficult. And how to do, and with the patient to patient variations are there that we should find out how exactly to manage this patient. Here, the miscarriage rate, even the patient becomes the pregnant, chances of miscarriage rate is highest at the age beyond 40. So one has to keep, one should not feel very proud that the patient has become pregnant now. There is lots of step to go up to the term pregnancy, and chances are there that this patient can have the miscarriage, they can have the IUD at any level. So we have to counsel this patient accordingly, and they should be prepared for each and everything. Of course, there is a reduced successful conception rate. And chances are there because the ovarian reserve is also decreasing. And this is the reason there is a reduced reproductive potential in these patients. Let's think over what is the biological aging and chronological aging. Of course, we know that the biological aging is that the women's specific reproductive competence or ovarian reserve is there, that is the biological age. But many times in youngster also, the in utero, there are the defective oocytes, and which starts inside the utero during the fetal ovarian development, and by the time they become in the reproductive age group, they have the defective oocytes, and it is difficult for them to conceive, or defective oocytes are very difficult, and they are less likely that there will be ovulation, and the chances of fertilization is also there. So we do not know exactly that how these defective oocytes are there. And if this is there at the age of 40, it is very, very difficult. Whatever the treatment you give to these patients, it will be very, very difficult that they will have the successful pregnancy. So there are the challenges for the fertility specialist, because here the age is rising. There will be the outcome of ART is adverse with the advancing maternal age. And of course, we should know that what are the optimized treatment which varies from patient to patient. So you have to take a clear-cut history, detailed history. You have to look for the investigation, and then only one can offer to these kind of patient that what exactly will be the perfect management for these patients. We should not show very rosy kind of picture that yes, you are the perfect IVF specialist and you will give the pregnancy to these patients. It is very difficult sometimes to make them understand, but counseling is must for these patients to make them understand that this is the problem with them. Yes, you will try to sort it out, but it's not necessary that 100% we will give the full guarantee that patient will be successfully get the pregnancy. So this age related infertility, of course, we have to treat something like this. So we will increase the monthly fecundity. That means we have to give the ovarian stimulation, and it can be the pulling of eggs may be there. So there are the different protocols which can be given, and we have to look for that, which is the perfect protocol for these patients, which really make them give more and more pulling, more and more oocytes when we are going to make them ovulate. So this is very much important, but only if we are increasing the number, it does not mean that the quality will also increase. So we exactly cannot say that I have done the IVF for the patient and in OPU I have taken out 7 eggs or 10 eggs and all the 10 eggs will be fertilizing. Probably there may not be any egg will be fertilized. So quality cannot be ensured with the number of eggs. So what are the options at this age? There can be ovulation induction combined with IUI. This may be possible in few patients where we see the antral follicular count is good and the AMH level is good and patient is well prepared that she won't feel distressed. She won't have the anxiety. You have counseled very well. Chances are there that she may be able to conceive with IUI. Number two option is IVF and ICSI, intracytoplasmic sperm injections. And one can do repeated cycle of ovarian stimulation, and one can do the pulling of oocytes. And finally, out of this pulling, 3 cycle, 4 cycle, 5 cycle of IVF can be done in these patients. And finally, we can collect the oocytes. And this may be possibility that these patients can have the good without aneuploidy, good euploid embryo, and probably that will be a successful implantation for these patients. And of course, if your own egg is not there, if the reserve is very poor, chances are there that you have to take the oocyte donation, egg donation, or if the male factor is also associated with that, then the embryo donation is the good example. And in young patient, one can have the self-fertility preservation for the time when it is after 40. And of course, today's science has come. The stem cell is also under the investigation, and it can be done with this. It can improve the ovarian reserve. So if it is IUI, it has been seen that after 40, if you do insemination, if there is no associated factor, uterus is very good, and there are the antral follicular count, chances of IUI success may be 8.5 per insemination, and pregnancy rate may be 70.9% according to this. But live birth rate, this insemination and this fertilization will be going towards the live birth rate. We do not know. It declines as the female is increased. So probably the miscarriage rate will be high in these patients, and they may not reach up to the term pregnancy. If the pregnancy goes, so you just look at this, between 40 to 42, chances are there in these patients, the 9.8%. But as soon as the female crosses 42 and she becomes 43, chance becomes absolutely half to 4.2%. And there is no live birth more in the year when she becomes 44 or more. So this has to be kept in mind that when you are talking, when you are counseling this patient, so we should make it absolutely transparent, transparent statement that, see, this is the situation, but still you will try for that. And we exactly do not know what will happen with your management. If we are going to stimulate, it has been seen whether you give the GnRH agonist with FSH or you give antagonist protocol, there is no difference in live birth rate when you do the insemination between the stimulation protocol. That means any protocol can be chosen for the patient according to her requirement when you investigate these patients. The IUI for older women, I'm not very much convinced, but I had a patient who had 6 months of married life only, very late marriage. She was 42 and she wanted to justify that my uterus is absolutely normal. The tubal patency test was done. It was absolutely patent tubes and the semen parameters were very good. Why not to do IUI? I was also convinced with her and I wanted to give the justification. So if the situation is like this, that patient is not agreeing with your counseling and she wants the IUI cycle, yes, why not give? And many, many times these patients conceive also with the IUI when the tubal patency is absolutely clearly it is patent and AMH is good. But if the IVF ICSI has to be done, in this paper, they have seen that the 500 IVF ICSI cycle more than 40 years, they have done it. And you can see that studies have shown the clinical pregnancy rate was only 10 to 15% when the patient was beyond 40 years of age who were going. And the biochemical pregnancy was only 17.6%. Ongoing pregnancy was 8.9% in these group. So this meta-analysis has shown that you have to counsel the patient properly. So they should be convinced that our success rate won't be more than like 50%, 60%. The pregnancy rate is only 17.6%. And we do not know out of this 17%, how many percent, like only 9% was going for the term pregnancy and rest went for the miscarriages. So this another paper also came, which has shown very clearly that at the age of 41, the delivery rate was only 7%. And I don't know how that this patient at the age of 43. So you have to judge how much is the anti-Mullerian hormone levels are there. If the patient had a very good build, as we see in the Western people, I had a patient who had a good ovarian reserve. Nearly 20 eggs were recruited and it has come out very well. But the fertilization rate was 50% and she couldn't conceive even though we had given her a very good blastocyst transfer. So we exactly cannot see the number is equating to the quality of eggs or the embryos. So what is the suitable ovarian stimulation protocol for these patients? This comes in the mind that whether the long protocol or short GnRH agonist protocol is the best one. It has been seen whether you give the long protocol or antagonist protocol, that means agonist protocol or antagonist protocol, the result is same. But it has been seen that if we are giving in these cases, the cycle cancellation in antagonist, less number of injections are required and chances are there that the patient is is more comfortable in this, and there is no problem in antagonist and agonist. There is no difference in success rate. So significant, naturally, in antagonist, less duration of stimulation, FSH dose is also raised, and this is very well, and the success rate is very well compared with the GnRH agonist. When it was compared with long GnRH agonist protocol, antagonist protocol, and the short GnRH, where we start giving short GnRH on the day one for 3 days or 5 days when we give agonist to increase the FSH level. It has been seen that this was not giving the very good benefit to these patients. So the short GnRH agonist regime is less effective when it is given in these age group, because it increases the progesterone level in early follicular phase. So this is very important message which should be taken, that many times in after 40, when there is a less number of follicles, less number of eggs are there, then we give in the early follicular phase, we give the agonist, but it increases the FSH, but simultaneously it increases the progesterone also, which gives the poor implantation to these embryos if it is transferred in the same cycle. Next question comes, what is the role of recombinant LH? In meta-analysis, it has been seen that when we supplement the LH with the ovarian stimulation, it gives the better result. So implantation rate increases and the clinical pregnancy rate also increases with the recombinant LH supplementation when this is given. So one can try this when these kind of patients are under stimulation. These days, we are also following the another regime, which is called mild stimulation protocol. The mild stimulation is protocol when you give the low dose gonadotropin, and it is an antagonist protocol. So what happens, that the milder dose to when in these patients for stimulation, it should not necessary that the follicles are few in number. So we should give the maximum dose, a good highest dose of the gonadotropin, so all the follicles should come up. This is the wrong thinking. So we can give the mild stimulation, and with the low dose, these patients can have the better chance. And this has been compared also with the classical protocol with the higher dose of gonadotropin, and it has been seen the mild stimulation will be having the beneficial option if the patient is stimulated beyond 40, and they will give the better quality of the embryos when fertilization occurs. So there are the so many adjuvants are also there, which has been tried, and we also try, still we are trying aspirin, and we are trying so many things for the IVF, that they should have the better implantation, they should have a better recruitment of eggs. But when you see the literature, it has been seen when you give the gonadotropin, the growth hormone, it has been seen. Initially, we thought that yes, it is a very beneficial, because growth hormone will be there, then the chances of recruitment of eggs will be better. But slowly, gradually, when the people started using it, it has been seen that there is no beneficial effect. The pyridose stigmine also has been tried. Even the low dose aspirin has been also tried, which gives the more vascularity in the endometrium. But it has been very clearly found that there is no beneficial effect, and it is not supported. When DHEA came, everybody jumped on this. Okay, this is the drug which is very, very useful, and it should be tried. But after using this, in a many, many patient, many literature came, many publication came for this, and it has been found that this is no useful in any patient when DHEA is used, whether it is a low poor ovarian reserve or the age is more than 40. Of course, the testosterone is still one which should be used 1 month prior to to these patients, and it can be used as a transdermal patches or a gel. It can be used, and it gives the better recruitment of eggs in these patients. And this is still going on very well. It increases the pregnancy by 15%. It increases the live birth rate by 11%. So the testosterone pre-treatment is very mandatory, very useful for these patients. Of course, the L-arginine also has been tried, and it has been seen that there is no benefit of this. So when this is the comparison has been done, I said initially, if a more than 40 years of a woman or a couple comes, then you immediately you will think, oh, it should be done IVF. We should not do. So there was a debate in the Canadian Fertility Andrology Society, and whether we should give the option of IVF as a first line of treatment or as a last resort. So it has been seen that in many patients, there will be a diminished ovarian reserve. So directly, the IVF should be done in these patients, whether you use with the clomiphene, with gonadotropin, letrozole with gonadotropin, or whether you just give the gonadotropin straight away without any oral or oral drug. So if there is AMH is good, if AMH is good and enteral follicular count is good, so these patients can be offered IUI with a good counseling. Of course, if AFCs are very minimal, if AMH is less than 0.8 nanogram, then chances of oocyte and embryo donation is a option, is the best option for these, but it requires the mental preparation, and one has to counsel them properly, because these patients can be given the donated oocyte from the young patient, which is having the better chances of fertilization, better chances of implantation, better chances of term pregnancy, and delivery rate are better. So this has been shown even at the age of 40 plus, the clinical pregnancy rate in these women were 53% and delivery rate was 40%. So the young oocytes can be easily implanted in these 40 plus patients, and these can be done very, very well in these patients, but it requires a mental preparation, it requires the good counseling, then only this option can be offered. The advantage of oocyte embryo donation, of course, because there is a risk of ovarian stimulation, you are giving in 40 plus patients, you are giving so much of estrogen, so much of FSH, so one has to think that these patients can have the problem, because in this age group, chances of diabetes, chances of the heart disease are very much there. But even after the oocyte or embryo donation, one should not forget that these obstetric complications like gestational diabetes, preeclampsia, thrombosis can be there in these patients. So they are a high-risk patient, and they require very, very close monitoring when these patients are these patients conceive, and they have to follow them very close with the close monitoring. Of course, there is another term like self-fertility preservation these days. If the patient is young and these patients are thinking that they should not conceive before 40, so they can preserve their embryos. If the male partner is there, they can preserve their oocyte also. But chances are there that these patients should understand that they are going to have the preservation of oocyte, and what how this will be effective in these patients, that has to be that should be very clearly defined with this. The world's first birth through the oocyte freezing and thawing was there in Australia in 1986, and in our country, Dr. Selvaraj has the first successful birth with the frozen oocyte in India also. So we are also trying to aim that these oocytes can be frozen, but one has to be very, very clearly understand that if oocyte cryopreservation is done, so we if in right in time they are preserving their oocytes, so there will be a chances that this oocyte can be used later. But question comes, how many eggs has to be preserved, and what will be the condition? What happens when we oocytes, we do the vitrification? What happens? These are very, very sensitive to low temperature. They are absolutely fragile. There is high water content, low surface volume ratio is there, and presence of spindle and other cell organelles. And what then these patients will have the ICSI with the sperms, chances of rupturing, the tearing off of the zona, because they are so fragile when we freeze, when we vitrify the eggs. Another chances are there that this has been seen, the oocyte survival rate, if it is less than 35 or more than 36, this study has shown that the live birth rate of the women, if the oocyte cryopreservation has been done in less than 35, or the chances are there that the 50% conception rate, live birth rate is there. But if it is more than 36 years, the people do the vitrification, chances of conception rate decreases by less than 50%. So again, it was defined that if the age is less than 29, then chances of 100% conception rate is there. But if it is 30 to 34 years, conception rate becomes 50%, less than 50, 45% it becomes. And as soon as it becomes more than 40, chances are nearly 3.7%. So we have to understand at what age the oocyte preservation has to be done. Then the question comes, how many oocytes should be frozen? There is a, it has been seen in patients that 22 vitrified metaphase II oocytes are needed to achieve pregnancy in women if the patient is 23 to 37 years. And if it is 2 to 3 ovarian stimulation has to be done, then only these many oocytes can be taken out. This is very much important. If it is 38 to 43 years, minimum 55 vitrified metaphase II oocytes are needed to achieve one pregnancy. And for the all age, at least 12 metaphase II vitrified oocytes are required. So one can understand how many oocyte retrieval has to be done, the ovum pickup has to be done to vitrify these oocytes, and how many gonadotropin injection and general anesthesia, all these has to be taken by these patients. So it requires a very detailed counseling of these patients. Of course, there is a risk when the patient is undergoing these procedure. So always there is a risk that there can be a injection, there can be an infection, there can be a damage to the organs, and all complication of the oocyte retrieval has to be explained. And of course, less than 5% ovarian hyperstimulation cannot be forgotten. So they should understand that yes, the OHSS also can be there. There is the risk for the oocyte cryopreservation, and it has been seen that it revealed no significant difference, of course, in the obstetric outcome, gestational age at delivery, birth weight, birth defect, Apgar. Absolutely, it is similar if it is done at the younger age or after 40. So it becomes the same if the patient takes this this oocyte cryopreserved eggs and the sperms has been done by the ICSI. Next one is the embryo cryopreservation. This is the best if it is done, because effectiveness and safety point is also there, that it can be, embryo can be preserved. And of course, there should not be given the lots of gonadotropin. So the OHSS should not be there in these cases. And one can make the HRT cycle, means endometrial preparation by with the hormones. And then one can transfer the embryos after thawing it. So success rate of, if you compare, the oocyte vitrification is increasing, the embryo cryopreservation is also very satisfactory. But in many countries, it is not allowed because embryo preservation, they don't allow because it is an embryo. So one has to be think about this also, to whom you are talking, that for the when you are talking about the oocyte preservation or the embryo preservation. Of course, the stem cell today is one of the science which is very well coming up. And if the patient has Asherman syndrome, if the ovarian tissue is very much damaged, or if the eggs are not there, so one can give this stem cell as a oocyte rejuvenation, and one can increase the ovarian size. And it has been seen, still it is in the research, but it has been seen that the number of eggs and the quality of eggs increases if it is done with the stem cells. Aspiration is done and it has to be injected in the ovarian tissue. Chances are there it becomes better. There are the technique that ovarian tissue cryopreservation is done, the ovarian rejuvenation with the stem cell with the autologous ovarian cortex is injected. The oocyte augmentation is also one of the procedure which is tried. Mitochondrial transfer, regeneration of endometrium, all these are in the research still. And the people are trying that after 40, if the patient comes or if the ovarian tissue is not there in the younger patient, how to increase the ovarian tissue, how to increase the oocytes or antral follicular count in these patients. And if uterus is not there, chances are there the uterine transplant also can be done. So people continuously are in the process that they should give the fertility as much as possible in these patients who really requires the assistance with this. Of course, this is the figure which is showing that as the age is advancing, the fertility is decreasing. And of course, with the age, the risks are increases when the patient becomes 40 or more. Early pregnancy and the maternal complication, we should not forget that these patients are early or later, the pregnancy complications are there, and chances of spontaneous abortion, we should not forget that these complications will be there more in these patients, and they should be very, very closely observed during antenatal period. You see that these patients, if it is more than 40, chances of pregnancy losses are 34 to 52%, where in the younger age group, it is 7 to 20%. And the risk of Down syndrome in these patients, when they are at the age of 40, chances are there in 1 in 85. And at the age of 44, it becomes 1 in 39, which is there in youngster, it is 1 in 1,477. So this has to be kept in mind that this kind of problem will be there. So these patients require the PGD, these patients require the close monitoring by this. All chromosomal anomalies can be there in these patients, which is very high. At the age of 44, it becomes 1 in 2. So it requires a very important counseling that this problem may be there. So they should be prepared for this, and they should go through all investigation for the pregenital counseling. We should not forget the advanced paternal age. The women are having menopause. What about the men? It is andropause. So this is another difficult question. Of course, the testosterone levels are decreasing. The sperm parameters are decreasing. So advanced paternal age is associated with autosomal dominant disorder. And there can be so many syndrome, the achondroplasia, the neurofibromatosis. So chances are there. Of course, it is a very less than 0.5%, but we should not forget while we are doing counseling to these patients. So we should know about it and it should be made very, very clear. So take home message for the practitioner is all couples should undergo through fertility evaluation before commencing ART. Low AMH level must be considered as a reason to discuss ART sooner rather than later. In women after 40, have the very low AMH consideration for the donor egg must be given. Patient with advanced maternal age have the worst ART outcome and are less likely to progress through each stage of ART. All patients should be counseled about the potential risk to both mother and baby. For the patient, when we counsel, they should understand the advancing age reduces likelihood of family. So they should understand that with the help of IVF or IUI, they should be able to conceive. It cannot be spontaneous because every month chances are decreasing. Like at the age of 40, it becomes 10%. At the age of 43, it becomes 5%. And of course, the pregnancy has the more complications like miscarriage, gestational diabetes, preeclampsia, preterm delivery, cesarean section, low birth weight should be also counseled. Of course, the miscarriage rate increases. So the conclusion is the intrauterine insemination in women over 40 is associated with low rate of going pregnancy, and IUI should not therefore be offered always as a first line of treatment. One should try to convince them, one should try to investigate them, then only this option has to be given. And when the predictive factors are positive for the IVF ICSI, one should give the chances of option of IVF ICSI. And of course, we should do the IVM, PGD, embryo vitrification has to be done, has to be explained to them, and it can be offered in these patients. The oocyte embryo donation remains the good option for the patient over 40 with the bad prognosis and can lead to successful ongoing pregnancy. Ovarian tissue cryopreservation, vitrification can be done in early age if they are planning the pregnancy after 40. Therefore, dear, healthcare providers should counsel women about the realities of biological clock and ensure they have realistic expectations about natural and assisted fertility rates if they choose to delay childbearing into their later reproductive years. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. So that was a very wonderful talk, elaborating all the points, all the issues with regard to the reproduction after the year 40. So we have quite a few questions in the virtual platform. So one thing is, yesterday in the Kerala newspapers, it was a very big headline that, am I audible, madam?
Yes, yes. Yeah.
In the Kerala newspapers, there was a headline, it's a big news that 71-year-old lady delivered because she lost her son actually in an accident earlier. So she got the ART done and delivered on day before yesterday. And the issue is that what is your viewpoint and what should be the viewpoint based on the proposed ART bill for these kind of activities? And see, in fact, the name of the IVF center has not been published. So that itself reveal, because it can be a cause of publicity, but at the same time, we exactly do not know whether the procedure has been done from Kerala or outside, but that the center has not been mentioned at all. So that particular people very well know that it is not the correct thing what they have done. Otherwise, they might have published that name at least. So what is your viewpoint and what is the viewpoint based on, what should be the viewpoint based on the current ART proposed bill? Over to you, ma'am.
See, in our country, there is no guideline at present. Files are still, the bill is still pending in the parliament. Till it comes as a bill, one is absolutely, openly everybody is doing like this. But when the bill comes, these people have the problem because they are doing their day-to-day practice like this. it is very clearly mentioned that after 45, one should not do ART in these patients. It is very, very clearly written. So if we start following from now only, then it will be a good one, because after Bill, they will have the problem. This is not the age. I remember in Haryana, 172 years old had the baby, and the, within a week, she had a cardiac arrest and she expired. What we are doing, we are the IVF specialist, we should not do all this. We should stick to our guideline, whatever is there. When the bill comes, it is all right. We will follow. But we should, the same bill, still it is in the guideline. We should follow the guideline and we should stick to that. We should not do all these kind of damage, which few IVF specialists are doing.
And another question is, see, because now the second wave of COVID is coming up, so many of the many of us start almost stopped doing IVF, and most of the embryo transfers, exactly the embryo transfers, are getting deferred. So will it be ideal to deny IVF for a patient who is more than 40 years, and of course less than 45 years? When the COVID pandemic is in very such that test positivity is almost reaching 50%, is it ideal to deny the treatment or is it ideal to give the treatment?
See, it is a best when we will stop for some time, when the declination starts, because still the peak is going on. So today only, my one patient had the ovarian stimulation. She came with cough and cold. I said, "Ki you get COVID," because it was done 10 days before and COVID became positive. And within 3 days, she expired. Today only I got the news. So why to give all these problems, give so many injections, FSH, estrogen, so her immunity will decrease and it will be very, very difficult to fight with corona. So it's better not to do at this moment. When the incidence rate, the prevalence rate starts coming down of the corona, then only we should start practicing again with full-fledged.
Yeah, so the message is very clear that the person who is living at present is more important than the baby which is going to be born or may be born in the future. And one question, clinical scenario, the question which has come up in the platform. 38-year-old patient with primary infertility, 6 cm adnexal mass, CA125 is 1300, and what should be, how to proceed with this patient?
Is this adnexal mass is a endometriosis?
No, it is clearly written that it is not an endometrioma. It is a
so we should evaluate
mass. Mixed heterogeneity with a solid mass, solid components.
So it is a solid, we should investigate her, whether it is a, this ovarian mass is a benign or a malignant. We should try to find out first. If it is simple TO mass, then it may be like this. So one can proceed further, but it requires the investigation, because I know one patient had a germ cell tumor and it came out as an immature teratoma. So in that patient, we should find out first, we should evaluate first, then only we should proceed the infertility management, not before.
Okay, one last question. Should we recommend PGT-A for all the patients?
This is the,
please ma'am,
the
please.
IOTA classification is very important to do it, and where it falls, because of the Doppler studies and the resistance flow studies, they will say whether it is a malignancy or it's a benign tumor, and you have to treat accordingly. And especially about the age group, when you take, you have to do the tumor markers, and then you should proceed. You just can't do, because she came with infertility, we cannot proceed to do it.
Very clearly, infertility is for years together. Her health is more important. Very rightly said, Dr. Ambuja. Very rightly said, yes.
And the second thing, Kunjimad, one more question they asked, I just want to answer, Joe, just for half a minute. They asked for the cutaneous adnexal masses. Yes, there is a thing like cutaneous adnexal masses, because the ovary and all, by origin, they have got the ectoderm, endoderm, and mesoderm. and the hair follicles, all these things, is possible to get the tumors, but it is very, 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 very rare, and it is only histopathological finding. It is not there. Hardly about 2 or 3 cases are reported, and that's also from somebody from Viragar Medical College from Pondicherry. They reported histopathology reports. That's all. So somebody asked that question. I thought I'll answer that.
Well, this dermoids, that's what I said. If it is a mature dermoid, we should try to take the oocyte retrieval. But if it is immature, which is a very progressive one, one should not try to touch them. This is my answer, actually.
Yeah, madam, the last question is, should we recommend PGTA for all the patients who are undergoing IVF after the age of 40, because the incidence of aneuploidy is very high?
Yes, why not? If they can afford, yes, one should do, because aneuploidy rate is very high in these patients. So we should give the euploidy, and they should be counseled. Sometimes, you know, if you take out 10 and all the 10 are aneuploid. So there are chances that there won't be any embryo transfer in that possible cycle. So they should be prepared for this if we want to give the successful pregnancy.
Yeah, thank you so much, madam. That's a wonderful discussion.
Thank you. Thank you. And I congratulate. I congratulate both of you, Dr. Ambuja and Dr. Kunju Mohideen, for making a very good webinar and keeping this great topic, which is really required for this time. Thank you so much.
So with that, we'll conclude the session. We'll move on to next session. It is the most awaiting panel discussion. Let me share the screen again.
Thanks.